Hello everyone, and welcome to another episode of Under the Covers with me, your host, Tom Hummer. In each episode of this show, I dig into a cover song, go through the details of how it's similar to and different from the original version, and discuss whether or not I think the cover is successful. Be sure to follow me on YouTube at Tom Hummer Music, or subscribe to the show wherever else you listen to podcasts, and also check out the Spotify playlist I have linked in the description, where you can find all of the songs discussed on this show in one place. So, summer has turned into fall here in Iowa, and in the fall I always listen to a lot of punk music. I don't know why, it always just fits. So as I hang up my swim trunks and pull on a hoodie, it just feels right to talk about a summery surf rock song's transition into punk rock. That's right, today I'm going full Peter Griffin to talk about Surfin Bird. Let's not waste any more time. Let's dive in. When I first started digging into this song and its history, I quickly found that this was not going to be a simple before and after like a lot of cover songs are. It's not a straight line, it's an evolution, and one that goes back a little further than I initially thought. So for today, our story starts actually in the middle before taking a step back to the beginning. In 1963, Minneapolis surf rock group the Trashmen, and let's pause there, yes, you heard me right, Minneapolis surf rock. Maybe the land of 10,000 lakes, but I'm not sure how many waves they're getting on those shores. Then again, I'm from Iowa, so I can't really talk. Anyway, Minneapolis group the Trashmen were attending a show where a band called the Sorensen Brothers were playing. The Sorensen Brothers played a song called The Bird Is the Word that the Trashmen had never heard before, and it really struck them to the point where they decided to riff on it at an upcoming gig. The whole thing was apparently very spur of the moment, with drummer/vocalist Steve Warrer improvising an outlandish vocal breakdown in the middle of the song, and eventually incorporating elements from a song called Papa Umau Mau by a doo-wop group called the Rivingtons, just due to the similar sound that it had. Oddly enough, the original version of The Bird Is the Word was also by the Rivingtons. The Trashmen had apparently just never heard that version before. They didn't know that the Sorensen Brothers were actually doing a cover when they heard them play it live. So where they thought they were mashing up two songs by two different bands and putting their own spin on it, they were really mashing up two songs by the same band, one of which they just never heard in its original form. At the gig where the Trashmen debuted this song, a DJ named Bill Deal happened to be in the audience and he pushed the Trashmen to record the track as a single. They did, and Bill entered it into a Minneapolis Battle of the Bands, where it won. He then entered it into a Chicago Battle of the Bands, where it also won. Shortly after, in November 1963, the Surfin' Bird single was released to the masses, selling over 30,000 copies in its first week, and eventually reaching number 4 on the Billboard Hot 100. Wanting to keep the momentum going, the Trashmen recorded an album in a whirlwind 2-day recording session, and released the Surfin' Bird LP in January 1964, just 2 months after the single. From there, they toured extensively and released some more singles, but as rock music became more progressive and drug-addled, the Trashmen didn't want to go down that path and instead brought the group to an amiable end in 1967. Now, breaking down the Trashmen's Surfin Bird doesn't really take much. The first thing you hear is the vocals, and that's very likely where your ear will stay for the rest of the song's 2.5 minutes, because that's just how odd and captivating they are.
Oh, well, everybody's heard about the bird.
When the rest of the instrumentals come in, they're fast, driving, and on beat. There's no swing to them. If you bob your head to the beat of this song, there's no bounce to it. It's like a jackhammer. The cymbals clang and swell under the weight of the compressor, which is working hard to contain a track that feels like it's going to burst out of its shell. Structurally, the first minute or so of the song is very uniform. Aside from a couple of quick refrains where the chords shift to what feels like the final four of a 12-bar blues progression, and a short drum breakdown, it's pretty much just a solid minute of the vocalist informing us about the bird and how it is in fact the word. Just past the minute mark, we get the vocal breakdown I talked about, where the name of the song is finally said, and some absolutely wild mouth sounds take place before ramping up into the Papa Mau Mau phase of the song. The instrumentals jump back in and follow the same progression from the first half of the song, with just the lyrics changing. The band sits on the same chord and this nonsense vocal progression for a long time, only switching it up for the one last "Don't You Know About the Bird" refrain, and ultimately going back to Papa Mau Mau for the fade out. One interesting thing to me about Surfin' Bird is how it contrasts from the rest of the album on which it was eventually featured. In most modern pop and rock music, an album is recorded and a single is selected from the album, which can help to promote and sell the album. This was the opposite. The single wasn't pulled from an album, the album was formed around the success of the single. This may have been a little more common in the 60s, but despite that, there's not much on the LP that sounds like Surfin' Bird. They didn't stick to the vocal gimmick that made the titular track a hit. The rest of it is pretty standard, clean surf rock by today's standards, although maybe a bit more aggressive and driving in some of the instrumentals. The closest they get to Surfin' Bird on the LP is Bird Bath, which has some instances of War's peculiar vocals, but that's it. With instrumental standards like Miserloo and Malogania, and a Buddy Holly cover, the LP feels relatively safe. This is intriguing to me because on one hand, I respect that they didn't want to sell out and pigeonhole themselves into a gimmick that became popular by pure accident, but on the other hand, if that's what the people want and that's what people know you for, you'd expect to hear a little more of it on the LP. Maybe they were just smart enough to know that a full album of that would quickly turn from endearing to irritating. I don't know. I've actually seen several people online, though, claim that Surfin' Bird is one of, if not the, first punk song, due to the driving instrumentals and the grating, unorthodox vocal style. I don't know if I'd take it that far, though. We could spend hours debating how to define punk, so I'm not going to go too deep into that. But while this has some of the key stylistic elements that I would consider to be punk trademarks, it doesn't have the right spirit or attitude to me. There's an ethos in punk that just isn't present here. However, it definitely makes sense as a progenitor to the style. The beautiful thing to me about the Trashmen's version of Surfin' Bird, though, is really how arbitrary and accidental it was. This was just four guys in their early 20s goofing around on stage, and the right person was there to encourage them to pursue something that was really just a live experiment. And that's why I think it's important to understand this story and the song's context. There's something so pure about it, and I think the best innovation often comes that way, when you just let your guard down, do something weird just for the sake of it, and then see how far you can run with it, see where it takes you. That process, that uninhibited creativity, for the sake of nothing more than curiosity and fun, is so much more potent than like an art rock band going into a studio and saying, "Okay, how are we gonna be edgy and boundary pushing today? Screw that contrived nonsense, you gotta just have fun and be free with it." So now let's take a step back to the true source, and here are a couple snippets of the Rivingtons' "The Bird Is the Word." And Papa Mau Mau. First off, it is funny to me how similar the two are. It's understandable why one of the songs would bring the other to mind, even if you didn't know they were by the same artist. And I don't say that to rip on the Rivingtons, they're a good group, but that's just how the style was. But what's really funny, when compared with Surfin' Bird, is how much more is going on in these two original songs. There are actual verses with lyrics. They may be a little ridiculous, but once again, that's the style. It's lighthearted and fun, and it sticks with you. What the Trashmen essentially did is take one tiny bit of the vocals of each of these songs, and even just the background vocal, and somehow milk an entire 2.5-minute song out of them. just taking one molecule of the Rivington's tracks and then hammering it into the ground while also radically simplifying it. And when I put it that way, it actually does sound pretty punk, doesn't it? The spirit of taking an idea, trimming the fluff, stripping it back to its basics, playing it loud and fast and evenly for 2 minutes, and then calling it. And actually, the fact that it takes a tiny snippet of another song or two and bases a whole song around that kind of sounds like a precursor to sampling. I don't know, I'm really starting to sell myself on this theory. Maybe the Trashmen were more innovative than I originally gave them credit for. Now let's fast forward 13 or 14 years to the Ramones. Their Surfin' Bird cover appeared as the second to last track on their third album, Rocket to Russia, which came out in November 1977. This is when punk music was hitting a peak, especially in New York City, where the Ramones were from, and this was released just a year and a half after their iconic debut record. While the Ramones were every bit the leather-jacketed, torn-trousered bad boys that they presented themselves to be, they never tried to hide their love for 50s and 60s rock and pop. They weren't too cool for that. Their debut album had a cover of Chris Montez's Let's Dance from 1962, the original of which even started with a 1-2-1-2-3 count-in that became a Ramones trademark. They had similar cover songs on many of their albums, but these elements are present even in their originals, and that's the thing I love about the Ramones cover of Surfin' Bird. The only differences between it and the Trashmen version are really the same differences between many other Ramones songs and late 50s, early 60s rock and roll in general. It's like they're telling us, hey, in case you didn't notice, here's the blueprint for a lot of our music. And this is especially true on Rocket to Russia. Put on Sheena is a Punk Rocker, Lock It Love, or Rockaway Beach from that album, and you don't have to try very hard to imagine Buddy Holly singing them. For the last two I mentioned, you hardly even have to change the lyrics. The Ramones' music has a classic songwriting element to it, right down to the melodic structures and two-minute runtimes. They're just presenting it differently, with chugging power chords and pounding drums instead of elegant, clean arpeggios and jazzy flourishes. And actually, as a band, they don't rely on power chords as much as they're made out to. They use a lot of nice full-bodied chords that just tend to be masked by the heavy distortion and maybe sound a little bit more like power chords sometimes. But anyway, I wouldn't be doing my job here if I left it at the high-level stylistic differences and moved on, so let's dig deeper. On first listen, it probably sounds like there's not much more to pick apart, but there are actually a handful of specific ways the Ramones are switching this song up that really amount to something, and the biggest one is the key. The chord progression in the Trashmen version goes from E to B to A, while the Ramones bring it up 5 half steps to A, E, D. Listen to the two intros right next to each other, and you'll hear the difference.
Well, everybody's heard about the bird. Bird. The bird's a winner. When everybody's heard about the bird.
Now, I'll admit, changing the key of a song usually changes the feel of it much more than it does here, just due to the relatively simple and silly nature of this one, but it's still notable. Next is the structure. Where the Trashmen go into the drum breakdown immediately after the first refrain, the Ramones add another verse-refrain-repeat before getting to that part, which pushes the vocal bridge to be about 25 seconds later than in the original. However, the Ramones version is only about 14 total seconds longer than the Trashmen's, and that's simply because they don't sit on the Papa Mau Mau section as long as the Trashmen did before going to the fade-out. The Ramones version is also actually a tad slower than the original. I clocked the original at about 198 beats per minute on average, while the Ramones were at about 192. So this will also stretch things out just slightly, but really that's a pretty negligible difference. Lastly, Joey Ramone simplifies the vocals by not adding as many of the improvisational affectations that Steve Warer did, where Steve would mix it up and do things like, "but bird's the word," kind of stuttering that first B sound. Joey keeps it pretty straight as bird, bird, bird is the word, bird, 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 bird is the word, the whole time. He also skips over the everybody's talking about the bird variation and leaves it as everybody knows that the bird is the word each time the refrain comes around. In reality, though, you know, I point out these differences because I feel like I've gotta, but they don't have a huge impact on the listening experience, and the Ramones version feels like a pretty faithful cover. My hypothesis, though, is that these differences were probably not intentional. They feel like the kinds of changes that would happen if you're just trying to play a song from memory that you liked when you were a kid. By the time the Ramones did Surfin' Bird, the original was 14 years old. It was kind of a novelty. It didn't have the recognition that it did when it first came out. And the Ramones don't strike me as the kind of band who would sit down, study the record, and say, you know what? I think we should do an extra verse repeat here, change the key a bit, adjust the tempo, and so on. What seems more likely is that one of them said, hey, remember that song Surfin' Bird? And Johnny started jamming on it using a random chord to kick it off, and they just played it based on how they remembered the song going. And I like that for a cover, just in general, because nobody's memory is perfect, and if you're just approximating it by memory, you're far more likely to embellish it with your own creative spin and add more of your own personality to it. And I'm just speculating here. Honestly, the truth is probably somewhere between those two extremes, but that's just the attitude I get when I listen to the Ramones version. But we're not stopping there. The year after the Ramones released their cover of Surfin' Bird, another American punk band called the Cramps released a cover of Surfin' Bird as their debut single. The Cramps originally formed in California, but they moved to New York in the mid-70s and became part of the music scene there, along with the Ramones. They were one of, if not the first example, of what's now labeled as psychobilly, taking old-school rock and roll and rockabilly and adding a noisy, manic, and unhinged flavor to it, along with more spooky and gothic imagery. But they also incorporated a lot of garage rock and what people would consider today to just be good old punk music. The Cramps were formed around the wife-husband duo of Poison Ivy, who primarily played guitar, and Lux Interior, who was the singer. Other members came and went, but it's worth noting that the lineup in their early days did not include a bass player, just drums, guitar, and vocals. Now, in some ways, the Cramps' version of Surfin' Bird is actually closer to the Trashmen than the Ramones. They're in the original key, and through the first part of the song, they're more faithful to the structure and nuances of the original than the Ramones were. They go to the drum breakdown and the bridge at the same time, and Lux Interior is doing all the same stuttered B's that I mentioned, along with the everybody's talking about the bird variation in one of the later refrains. Despite coming out the year after the Ramones version, from a band in the same city and same scene, this doesn't feel like a cover of a cover. It's a direct line from the original. And in a lot of ways, the Cramps sound in general is even closer to the Trashmen's. Their guitar and vocal styles take a lot from surf rock and rockabilly, with the heavy use of tremolo, delay, and reverb. Where the Ramones had more mid-range chugging in their guitars, the Cramps embrace more high-end, bright-sounding guitar tones, and if you listen to more of their discography, even just as far as their debut album, Songs the Lord Taught Us, they've got several songs based on 12-bar blues progressions. Now, right around the time that we would be reaching the end of the original, between the 2-minute and 2.5-minute marks, is where this thing goes completely off the rails. The Cramps devolve into a mess of grating guitar and frantic vocal ad-libs. Lux Interior's echo-laden yelps become an unsettling rhythmic component of the song, rather than a melodic one, very similar, in fact, to what Alan Vega was doing vocally in Suicide, another New York City group from the same era. This madness continues for another 3 minutes. This thing is over 5 minutes long, for God's sakes. Over twice as long as the original. And the last 2.5 minutes is punk indulgence at its finest. And eventually, when they've decided that they've had enough, or maybe that you've had enough, they just go ahead and cut it off. They don't fade out like the Trashmen version or the Ramones version. They crash and burn into the ending. I mentioned that at this point in the band's lineup, they didn't have a bass player, and I think that's an important part of how this recording turned out. A lot of punk music from this era has a buzzsaw aesthetic, guitars with tinny high-end, noisy mid-range, and little to no low-end. But most bands, like the Ramones for example, had bass guitar to anchor the sound and fill out the low-end of the mix. The lack of bass guitar in the Cramps Surfin Bird not only makes the aesthetic more abrasive, but it makes the performance as a whole feel untethered. The guitars clang, the drums crash, the vocals are chaotic, and there's nothing else to cut through the mix and provide the listener with a solid point of reference to where you are in the song. Outside of the music itself, there's one thing I want to come back to that makes the Cramps cover of Surfin' Bird so intriguing to me. It's their debut single. When you're releasing a debut single, you are establishing your identity as a band, as a creative force. You are introducing yourself to the world. Why would you spend that opportunity presenting your audience with a take on someone else's work rather than giving them something that's 100% you? Well, I have some theories about that. When we listen to a band for the first time, there are two main things we're taking in that inform us of who the band is: the sound and the songwriting. The sound is something we can start to grasp in an instant. We get a sense of the instrumentation, the production style, the vocal style, and how it all blends together. It tells us what aesthetic the band is going for, and we get that by how the first few notes land on our ears. And maybe they'll surprise us with some twists and turns in the sound. As we continue to listen through that first song, and the second, and the third, and so on, we adapt our understanding of the band's sound based on the variations we're hearing as our ears take in more data. But first impressions are still important, and that gut reaction to a sound can be strong. We get a lot of information about this in just 10 or 15 seconds of listening. Songwriting, on the other hand, is much more a function of time. We can't get a sense of a band's songwriting 15 or even 30 seconds into a song, unless you're listening to The Locust, maybe, but that's another story. But this is because understanding songwriting is all about what the artist does next, from where you are in that moment. It's as much about what you've heard them do as what you haven't heard them do yet. Melodies, structures, chord progressions, all of these things have multiple parts, and that flow is what matters. A single chord means nothing in itself. It only matters in the context of what's around it, and what chord you're moving from to get from A to B. Not necessarily A chord and B chord, but point A to point B. And often we can't fully grasp these nuances of a single song even on the first listen. We have to replay it several times until we're familiar enough with it to anticipate what comes next. And only then can we really understand and appreciate the writing that went into that song. Do that for several songs by the same artist, and we start to understand the bigger songwriting picture for that artist. So in choosing to launch their career off of a cover song, assuming that listeners are familiar with the original, what the Cramps are doing is taking songwriting out of the equation and out of the listener's mind. We're not going to pay attention to lyrics or chord progressions or structure because we already know what to expect from those elements, and we know that they weren't creative decisions made by the Cramps. Instead, we're forced to focus solely on the sound and what they're doing differently from the original, because that's the part that is their creative vision. And that's where the Cramps established themselves so successfully on their version of Surfin' Bird. That 2 or 3 minute freak out at the end defies our expectations based on what we know of the original and makes a bigger statement about who the Cramps are than if they had thrown that at the end of an original song. Because we're just not expecting it. We know what Surfin' Bird should sound like. We know that it doesn't have a 3 minute instrumental freak out at the end. So when we hear that, it tells us a lot. They're giving us a glimpse, a tease of who they are by telling us who they're not. They're not the Trashmen that the previous generation was listening to 15 years earlier. They're something newer, fresher, and scarier. But they're also reminding us that this new, fresh, and scary sound is an evolution of that familiar surf and rockabilly sound. There's a more direct line there than you'd think if you're only thinking about the production, performances, and the general way the artist presents themselves. It reminds me a bit of when Danzig did that Elvis cover album last year, and a lot of people were really baffled by it. And I'm like, have you ever heard Last Caress by the Misfits? The melody and chord progression sound straight out of the Elvis catalog. But you have to separate the songwriting from the sound in order to see that. It's easy to get hung up on Danzig and the Misfits' image in a similar way that you can with the Cramps, but they pulled a lot of their songwriting foundation from artists like Elvis and Roy Orbison. And it's not limited to those artists. The fact is that many punk bands took significant influence from 50s and early 60s rock and roll, and while to us in the 2020s it may sound wildly different, there's one important way that they're the same. They were both dangerous. People were getting as much, if not more, bent out of shape about Elvis and Chuck Berry as they were about punk bands in the late 70s and early 80s. By the late 60s and early 70s, rock music had become mainstream and lost a lot of that danger. But punk music revamped the presentation and dirtied up the lyrics, making it sound fresh and dangerous again, reclaiming the sound for a new generation of rebellious youth. So while the tunes from the two eras may not sit on our eardrums in quite the same way, I would argue that the ethos they share transcends something as trivial as production or performance style. So, are these covers of Surfin' Bird successful? I certainly think so. And not just because they're enjoyable to listen to, but for the deeper reason that they bridge a generational gap and help us identify the common threads between music that on the surface may not sound so similar. Surfin' Bird has been covered several other times over the years too, but for me, the Ramones and Cramps versions really set the bar. They're the ones that I come back to, the ones that I think of when I think of this song. But what do you think? Leave a comment and let me know, and once again, please subscribe to Under the Covers wherever it is that you listen to podcasts, and follow me on YouTube at Tom Hummer Music. Also, be sure to check out the ongoing Spotify playlist with all the covers and originals discussed on this show. And finally, thank you all so much for listening.